We can move on then to...
Anna, please.
So, Benjamin, are you... I'll unmute you there. Do you want to go ahead?
Yes, please.
Okay, we are. Good morning, everyone. And
good morning, Benjamin. From humanity you, to you in Africa.
Well, thank you all.
Would you like to share with us your screen?
Okay. So we are willing to share with you our corrected results. So where is you can see what is actually happening in Ghana, and these are some of the news headlines I gathered. If you go online, you can find some of these things. Illegal mining destroy river Boison and Bia. Galamsey induced water shortage hit about 50 communities. Ampra contains cancer-causing chemicals. Okay, that is Ghana Water Company is attesting to that. And Galamsey plunges Ghana into water crisis. That you can see, that is recent, 19 of February. That's a recent news that was on the website. Okay, this is one of the key members or key people in the Ghana Water in Sewage Corporation, and he's telling us that fluoride content in water has, which was supposed to be 1.5 for human consumption, which I even find it too high because fluoride is not good for us. If you read a book by Dr. Jerry Tennant, you can find out the health implication about fluoride in water. And it's a good book. I actually have read this whole book, Voltage is Healing. If you can get to Amazon, you pick a copy for yourself and then you see what Jerry Tennant, you know, has discovered about fluoride. This consumption in fluoride has written, they have to raise the standard to 2.3, and this is unacceptable and is dangerous for human as far as dental health is even concerned. Okay, he said that the increment in fluoride content of water cannot be treated once it has found its way in water, making the situation more dangerous. According to Mr. Pintle, another mineral found in the water which was equally dangerous was mercury. Okay, so there's a high content of mercury, and as I share further, you can see that you cannot treat it the normal way that water is being treated currently. So our technology offers a possible solution to all this because of the gravitational and the magnetic field which is incorporated in the GANS, which eventually can pull this thing down as sediment. He currently also said that the company spent more than estimated amount of money to treat water because at times the pollution becomes so high that it has to pump away all the 3,000 gallons of treated water from, that is after testing, you know, they do the quality control analysis, and it is normally found out that, you know, this water is not a consumer, cannot be consumed, so they have to pump it away because they don't know how to deal with the situation. Okay, and that is another what do you call it, he said the situation, this is a pumping station in where the Brim River is, and they said the situation has caused Ghana Company to shut down the water treatment plant that treat water at Brim River for the resident. So it's a huge problem here. Okay, and what is the cause of water then? How do we, you know, water is life, so how do we get clean water, because it's cost so much to treat water than to get it in this pure, you know, state. Currently, that is the mode of treating water in the cycle that water that is clean, you know, comes out. It has to go through this three major process, which is further divided into five processes. That is the pre-treatment, filtration, and post-treatment processes. Okay, first of all, the water have to be disinfected, and Secondly, coagulation and flocculation treatment process, and sedimentation process, filtration process, and then corrosion control process. So as you pump this water along the tubes, they are not they don't end up corroding the pipelines. Okay, so this is a pictorial view of what it looked like in Ghana before I left, you know, to Europe. Water is pumped from the river, and then at the initial stage they boil it, you know, they boil it to kill the or to treat the germs first, and then afterwards they add alum for coagulation, and then they, you know, go through the process of, you know, changing the taste or to control the odor through carbon, and then you get to disinfect it by adding chlorine to it. And chlorine, as I continue, you see that it has even a very negative implication on our health, you know. And then the next stage is the water undergoes a filtration process, and then the sediments have to sink down, and then it is pumped. And then again, we add another chlorine to it again. That means we have added chlorine in two stages, making the water somehow clean and pleasant to drink, but the health implication is very costly. Okay, then this is the post-treatment stage. The last stage is the post-treatment stage. You add another sodium chloride, you know, to sort of avoid corrosion in the pipelines, and then you get your clean water out. I know this system, you know, is common to most water treatment plants across the globe. Okay, so let's see what chlorine has to chlorine, the negative impact of chlorine in water treatment. This is what I got from H2O water distributors site. Okay, so I haven't changed anything and I didn't write anything, but I know the implication. They are just echoing what we have found out. Okay, chlorine has an extreme drying effect, not only on the hair but on the skin. As the skin becomes drier, it also ages more quickly. So just as you can add chlorine to filter your water, you can also add a filtration system to your entire home system. That is, if you want to avoid the, you know, negative impact of, you know, chlorinated water. What many people may not realize that is that chlorine has a definite aging effect on the skin. So when you use so much chlorine, you know, your skin tend to age, you know, faster. What those same people may not also know is that chlorine was chosen as a primary disinfectant for our water supply for its safety, but it cost, okay? But that cost has not factored in health risk which comes from drinking chlorinated water. The risk of developing cancer, for example, is more than 90% higher than those regularly drink chlorinated water than those who do not. Okay, this is by Michael Ryan. You can get this article in, also from Enzyme. Okay, and these are some of a lot of, you know, from different people. This is a medical doctor, J.M. Price. Chlorine is the greatest crippler and killer of all modern time. While it prevents epidemics of one disease, it is creating another. 2 decades ago, after the start of chlorinating our drinking water in 1904, the epidemic of heart trouble, cancer, and salinity began. Okay, that's a medical doctor speaking. And this is another from Air and Toxic Risk Assessment, that is 1991. Other studies have indicated that exposure to chlorine via inhalation may alter disease resistance in animals with higher incidence in emphysema, pneumonia, and tuberculosis, you know. So that is the disease that you can also get. Let's listen to another doctor, Dr. Lance Wallace. Showering is suspected as a primary cause of elevated levels of chloroform in nearly every home, because the chlorine in water, that is chloroform, also known as carcinogen, levels increase to about 100% during 10 minutes in your residential shower. So that is how you gradually actually poison yourself, because the skin area is actually the large part of your the greater part of your intestine, or you can take in more fluid via your pores than, you know, drinking. So when you enter into water, you know, the water gets into your pores faster, and you can easily, you know, poison yourself, or, you know, get another side effect. The next one is from a professor of water chemistry at the University of Pittsburgh, claims that the exposure to vaporized chemical in water supplies through showering, bathing, and inhalation is greater than through drinking. So you see why? Because the skin area has a lot of pores, and you can easily, you know, get this chemical into your bloodstream faster than you taking it. Now, let's look at our treatment method. When you look at the diagrams that I showed earlier, you see that it undergoes a lot of processes. But using the GANS, you don't need all these systems. You know, you don't need all the systems that are associated. You may only need about two or three, you know, only two. Maybe let's say the water is pumped, you get your, you know, GANS in the water, and then the sediments sink. While the sediment is sinking, you are also dealing with the mercury levels or the heavy metals, you know, that is embedded or laced within the structure of the water down. And then the upper part, which has shown itself to be clean, you know, can be used as drinking water. So the cost that is involved in buying high cost of machinery and so on can be dealt with, not alone man hours and then the manpower involved, you know. So using this technology, we can cut away this cost that most African countries or most developing countries, you know, face. So like here I'm showing samples that I've submitted to the NNI, the National Nuclear Research Facility Lab here, to deal with. This is the treated water from Brim, and I know some of you have already seen it. And that was, we started the process at this particular date, 15th of February at 14:38 p.m. And then we came to it the next day. The control still remained the same, but when you look at the one that has the copper oxide in it, you can see that it is more, what do you call it, clearer. And Nash is actually working on this results also simultaneously with the other ones that I have submitted. Actually, I have loaded him with so much work that, you know, there are a lot of samples that they are analyzing for us, and we will show that also with time. He was supposed to come with the sediment, but yesterday there was a power outage, you know, I think 2 days or so. 2 days they have been a power outage at the atomic site, so it has stalled, you know, the process. Okay. And these are also the effect from adding ordinary nano wires to the wire. That was when we started, that is how it looked. And after 24 hours, the next day, you know, the water is a little bit clearer, and it is more clearer now as it sits on their laboratories now. So we can, in effect, you know, research, further research or further, you know, tuning of this method, we can cut costs and then save money for third world countries. Okay, so he's here. I have the corrected results. Nash is here. He will, you know, go through with us again. What?
Yeah. Good morning, Mr. Keshe and group. As we went through the other time that we met, we found out that there were interchanges in some of the results of the parameters, especially with turbidity. With turbidity, we had the offin control, which is now being corrected, is 200, but after the treatment, it dropped to 32. Then with the Revapra, the control was 226. After the treatment, it dropped to 4, which is even below the guideline values for drinking water according to WHO and Ghana standard authority levels. Then we came to the color. The color of fin control, we found it to be 220. After treatment, it dropped to 20. Then Revapra, the control is 50. After treatment, it dropped to 1, which is very significant. And even with WHO, the apparent color, it should be 25. But after treatment, especially with Revapra, it has dropped to 1, which is very significant and very encouraging. The true color, as it follows with the apparent, the offin control 22, but the true after filtration for the true color came to 15. Then the treatment too after filtration, it dropped to 3. The same with Revapra, the control after filtration was 50, but after the filtration came to, it dropped to 5. Then the treated, just 1, came to 0. And these are all, that is the treatment values are all below the drinking water level, which is very, very good. Then we also had a look at the nitrate values. The nitrate for offin control was 0.406. Then the treatment, after treatment, it dropped to 0.318. Then with Revapra, it was 53, which is extremely high, but it dropped to 0.002, that's after the treatment. The recommended levels according to WHO is 10 to 45, and then Ghana Standard Authority is 10. Then we also had a look at the phosphate levels. The phosphate river offin control was 0.683. After treatment, it dropped to 0.034. Then with Revapra, the control was 2.066. After treatment, it dropped to 0.012. Sulfate was 2.5101 for the offin control. Then after treatment, it came to 2.0089. Revapra was 0.218. After treatment, it came to 0.14. So basically, these are the corrected results that we have. As Ben already said, we've also analyzed the sediment from the samples, and by next week, we will come out with all the metals that we are possibly been analyzed for the sediment.
So thank you
very much.
Okay, so that is the final result, and it's very encouraging, you know. And as you see on the screen, this is something that we are, it is in the process now. We are, you know, we have started the process, and with time we will give you all the...
Benjamin, yes, before sir? You go any further, go back to the report, please.
The report, okay.
Can you expand, can you open it that we can see the results? Because last time we found discrepancies in typing, person was typing it. Can you go up, please? Can you open it? Open it, open the figures. We want to see the figures. We'll go back. Okay. We need to see the chart. Go, yeah, go down. Where is here? There is the report here. Open this report. Oh, can you open it, Rick? We can't see the figures.
It's a picture, and they need to. You need to show the actual report so that we can see the figures more correctly. Or else, try to. If you can make this picture bigger in your program there, I think it's only at 65%. If you could make it 200%, maybe we can see the numbers better.
You worked so hard because to analyze with Dr. Binger, with you, in what...
You could actually just use the percentage slide on the bottom right corner.
Okay.
You can increase the size. It says something about 60%. You can make it bigger there.
Go back to
right,
the...
Right, that might work.
Go back to the screen again, in what you had. Okay, what is, can we have with the Dr. Nash analysis on this data? Yes, can you tell us with now that we have the figures, can we understand what is the property of the water now after the processing and or after residual?
Yeah, after the processing, let's say we take the pH compared to the guideline values for WHO and Ghana Standard Authority. It's the range, the guideline level is 6.5 to 8.5 for the WHO. And after treatment, we are within 7.62 for River Ofin, and then 7.55 for River Pra, as they treated. Then when we come to the conductivity, WHO level is 500 to 700. And we, after treatment, we are between, we have 268 for 0.5 for River Ofin, and then 178.2 for River Pra.
What does this mean? What does it change this in the quality of water conductivity?
Yeah, the conductivity, it's the amount of metals that are in dissolved in the water.
Mm-hmm.
And these, some of these metals are health hazards. So
does it show that the metal content has reduced?
Yes, it has reduced considerably.
What was the percentage of loss? It's nearly half, isn't it?
Nearly half.
Okay, and then what about the next one?
The next one is the total dissolved solids, which is also, the guideline value is 1,000. But after treatment, we are below even the guideline value of 1,000. We are 134.65 for River Ofin and 88.9 for River Pra, which is very good and very, very encouraging.
So it dropped from 1,000, is it 1,079 or is it 179?
It's 134.65 for the River Ofin and then 88.9 for River Pra.
What was before? Because we don't see it clearly. Is it 1,100?
Yeah, and it was the guideline value is 1,000, but the control, that is the untreated, for River Pra is 179. But after treatment, it dropped to 134.65. Then for River Pra, the control was 1,164.45. Then after treatment, it dropped to 88.9. So from 1,000, down to 88.
What does this usually contain?
The dissolved solids, that's what we are analyzing the sediments now to find out actually what kind of or what type of metals are embedded in. So we, after the complete analysis of the sediment, now we will be able to tell the dominant metals in the or in the sediment. We will be able to know the iron content, the copper content, the zinc, the manganese, cadmium, lead, if there are some of these hazardous elements in, which is a health hazard, I must say. With suspended solids, the control, which is on treatment for orphan, is 210. After treatment, it dropped to 35. Then the PRAC untreated is 230. After treatment, it dropped to 5, which is exactly the guideline value according to WHO and Ghana Standard Authority. For alkalinity, which states the either the basic or the alkaline nature of the soil, of the water sample, the orphan control is 75. After treatment, it dropped to 45. Then the river pra, the treatment should be the control or the untreated should be 105. After treatment, it dropped to 65. The control, the guideline values are...
I think your officer has mistyped it back to front.
Yes, the alkalinity too also skipped. It's also interchanged, which we have noted. This, the 75 should be in place of the 45.
And then the 105 the other way around, okay.
Or the other way around.
Yeah. The next one is?
Next one is turbidity. Turbidity, the untreated is 200, that is orphan control is 200. After treatment, it dropped to 32. The PRA control is 226. After treatment, it dropped to 4.
You explained to us last time what turbidity was. Was the clarity of the water?
The clarity of the water. The clarity of the
when
water.
When you pass a light through it, it must be able to be seen. Or when you put something behind the container which is holding the water, a transparent, a transparent container.
Benjamin, we can't hear you.
Okay. When you
The turbidity is, for example, when you have put it in a transparent plastic bottle, when you hold a paper behind it, you should be able to see through the content of what you are holding, or you should be able to have a clear image without blur. So that is the dispersion rate of light is able to, you know, go through without, you know, becoming opaque. That is simply what turbidity actually means.
Okay. Thank you very much. What's the salinity?
Salinity for orphan control was 0.2 parts per trillion, that is PPT. But after treatment, it dropped to 0.1. That's about 50% down. Then the PRA control came to, it's the untreated is 1.1. After treatment, it came to 0.1. That is, it tells the how salty the water is when it is consumed.
Did you manage to get the unsalted GANS this time? You found the distilled water for it?
Yeah, I wash it this time.
No, don't shout. Come to the microphone.
Okay. Okay. What, I got iron, deionized water from the NNR lab. By the courtesy of Professor Dr. Shiloh, who is interested in our work. So he told me to bring a big gallon, and they were able to offer me a lot, you know, for my experiments.
Okay, carry on, please.
So we now come to apparent color, that is the color of the water as it was submitted to the lab. It's a obscene control was 220, but after treatment it dropped to 20. The accepted level is 25, so this is quite good. Then for prior control, it's 50. After treatment, it dropped to 1, making it very almost colorless, just like distilled water. Then the true color is after it has been filtered. The offing control was 220, but after filtration, it came to 15. Then the treated offing water, which was 20 for the apparent, after filtration, to get a true color, it dropped to 3. For PRA, the control was 50 untreated. After filtration, it dropped to 5. Then the treated river PRA came to 0 for the true color. The WHO level is even 5. So compared to the treatment was more effective than the control, than the guideline value for the true color. Then we came to nutrients and other chemical tests. And we start with fluoride. The fluoride for the offing control was 0.015, but after treatment, it dropped to 0.011. That's about 0.004 difference. Then the PRA control...
That's about 35% reduction.
About 35%, exactly. PRA control that was 0.033. After treatment, it dropped to 0.001. Even the guideline value for fluoride is 1.1, 1.5 for WHO, and then 1.0 to 1.5 for Ghana Standard Authority. So here too, the treatment has clearly shown to be one of the best. Then for chloride, the offing control was 48.98. After treatment, it dropped to 9.99, which is a reflection of the salinity level, because chloride also contributes to the salinity. Then for PRA control, we have 596.81. After treatment, it dropped to 28.99. The guideline value is 250 to 1,000 according to WHO, and then 250 for Ghana Standard Authority. So we realized that the treatment was even below the guideline values. Then we come to sodium. Sodium for offing control was 17.9. After treatment, it dropped to 13.2. That's about 4.5 difference. Then PRA control was 85.7. After treatment, it dropped to 16.8. And the guideline values is 200 for WHO and 200 also for Ghana Standard Authority. So here the treatment has also clearly shown how effective the treatment is. Then sodium for offing control was 2.5. After treatment, it dropped to 1.5. Then PRA control was 6.5. After treatment, it also dropped to 1.0, which is far below the guideline value, which is 30 for WHO. Then for total hardness, we have 65 for offing control. After treatment, it dropped to 52. PRA control was 48, and after treatment, it's also, this should be it dropped to this should be 18, but they have made it 48, the same 48, should be 18 for total hardness. The guideline values are 500 for both WHO and Ghana Standard Authority. Then for nitrate, the offend control was 0.406. After treatment, it dropped to 0.318. Then for prior control, it was 53. And after treatment, it dropped to, this it should be 0.53 for prior control. After treatment, it dropped to 0.002. The guideline values for WHO is 10 to 45, and then Ghana Standard Authority is 10. Phosphate for offend control was 0.683. After treatment, it dropped to 0.034. Then for prior control, it was 2.066. After treatment, it dropped to 0.012. We don't have the guideline value for phosphate yet, WHO and Ghana Standard, but the guideline values are not in yet. Then for sulfate, the offend control was 2.5101. After treatment, it dropped to 2.0089. Then for prior control, it was 0.218. But after treatment, it's dropped to 0.014. The treatment levels, according to WHO and Ghana Standard Authority, were to be 250 to 500. So far, is what we okay. have.
As a scientist yeah. who is qualified to give us a verdict, what does this result give us? There is a very strange characteristic that the offend
yep.
shows totally ratio than pra.
Because the offend was treated with CO2 GANS, and then the pra was treated with copper oxide GANS. So
copper oxide shows a better performance than CO2.
Sure.
But the CO2 costs nothing to produce where copper oxide does.
Yeah.
Now, can we speak with Dr. Nash, please, Benjamin? Dr. Nash.
Yes, Mr. Keshe.
Yeah. What is, we see a lot of reduction, okay.
Yeah.
We see a lot of improvement in reduction of the all sorts of things. But
yeah.
are these all beneficial to be withdrawn? Or can be selective and keep some? Water without yeah. nourishment is no good, but part of these things are nourishments for animals or whatever. Can we become selective? I mean, is this water okay for consumption, most probably, but void of everything, yeah. more or less.
Yeah, we realized that with the copper oxide treatment, it's more effective than the carbon dioxide. Mm-hmm. And it's, even when you look at the guideline values for drinking water, you realize that some of the parameters, it's even lower than the guideline values, telling us that the treatment using copper oxide has been very effective. These guideline values came about when we haven't come across the treatment with copper oxide and carbon dioxide. I believe the guideline values are from what Ben earlier shown, the traditional way of water company here going through the processes of treating water. So based on that filtration or the treatment system, that's why they came out with these drinking values. And now that we have advanced forward with copper oxide treatment coming in, we realize that we can even go lower than the guideline values, which has been set for some years now.
So would your government consider to implement this?
Yes, and I'm sure they would, but they will call for further tests on a wider scale, and that will go through the processes, and the government will surely, because this is even cheaper compared to what we are spending treating our water for public consumption at the moment. So it's a big breakthrough if all hands on deck, relevant people are brought on board, and we sure the government will give an ear to it.
Is it possible to get the couple of error on the page to be corrected? And
yeah, sure.
If we could have a written report, a scientific report of the evaluation of this result that we can share with number of governments, because this allows a huge difference in, because especially when I look at the salinity, the salinity with copper oxide, this allows the sea waters for countries like here in Dubai to be literally cleaned out. You can drink it, you can put it through and drink it. How long did it take? How long did you leave the two to stay? A day?
3 days.
3 days. Was it effective immediately or after 3 days you got to this point? Would it be any different if it would have been just 1 day?
After putting it down, we started seeing changes after 1 hour. The water was clear. So Dr. Nana was even asking me, why is the other one, that's the copper oxide, going, you know, clearer than... But I have already tested it in my room and then have found out that the copper oxide, you know, gets clearer faster than the CO2. So I just...
Okay. Benjamin, what is important, we need to see now, we have a base data on each river. We have to see if the material which is collected must be in the what do you call it, in the residual which you are testing. Yeah, we should find the correlation between the two. It's got correlates. Otherwise, it won't be, we will see where it's gone to. What will be interesting is, can you, once they've done the test, can you try to see if you can wash the copper oxide or the CO2 out of the residual that we can reuse it?
Okay.
You understand? So does not matter what is as a residual, there are processes that can take the gold out, whatever. You haven't tested a lot of other things here, but would it be possible to wash the CO2, because we do the washing, Armin is good at it, that we can recycle the material, we don't need to use this to keep on producing it. You understand? Hello, Benjamin. Have we lost him?
Yeah, we might have lost him.
We'll see when he comes back, bring him back on, because he's got to explain to us the other part. What we see here is more or less in line we've seen with a couple of other reports. But now, with this report, we try to pass this on immediately to certain governments. We know they are working to clean the system up, the process. It is important that we make a proper report of this and in time understand it more. I've seen these kind of work past 10 or 15 years. We were fully aware. Is the first time we receive a governmental report. And we'll start seeing these kind of reports across the world. A lot of governments, companies, organizations are doing it. I'm sure if we can get Benjamin in the background, we will take this with us to China. China has a lot of rivers which needs to be cleaned up. And this has a very little cost of drinking water changes. At this moment of time, I was in a seminar the Monday before. Official seminar by the United Arab Emirates regarding the water. The amount of water which is imported in the United Arab Emirates is huge. Every drop of water is brought in. Because desalination units, especially like companies which are very big in it, like Samsung, it costs a fortune to do it. This is an easy way out. It allows us to drink water from everything we like. In the rivers, in time of disaster, people like a lot of you who carry copper oxide, now you can use it. But at the same time, if we add to the information that we learn for the future, if you test, we tested these with minerals, but if you do a germ test, microbe test, from the data we have, copper oxide comes totally clean. CO2 creates life. So in cleaning up, if you are taking the residual out, is good. But if you're going for a totally disinfected water, that you can literally drink it, doesn't matter what kind of parasite was in it or microbes, you'll find out the copper oxide comes on the top. So we've seen the process, we understand the process, but copper oxide has shown in number of trials to be a disinfectant. So in having this data, I think we will speak with Benjamin in the time. Is Benjamin back?
Not yet.
I will discuss this with them in the background. You will see that copper oxide has a huge disinfection. It disinfects the water, kills all the germs. It doesn't kill, it literally takes them out into the sediment. They still survive. In the sediment, they do exist. In the above, they don't. And I don't recommend the CO2 water drinking, but the copper oxide, when you let it settle, has the property to be...
Okay, got that.
Hello.
Go ahead, Mr. Keshe. Sorry, we had somebody drop out there, which caused our mics to open. So you go ahead now. Thank you.
No problem. So we know this. We hopefully, when we are in China, because the water contamination is huge in China, we know this as the number of lakes in what used to be USSR, the Russian, like in Kazakhstan, I'm aware of the huge lakes which have huge contaminations. This technology, this copper oxide, can be used in the condition of radioactive contamination. If you come, we expect a huge disaster in US in the coming time. Not US, but the continent of America and the whole South.
Sorry, Mr. Keshe, we are back.
Okay, thanks, we are back. Just wait 1 second, I'll explain something. If we expect with these disasters, like what happened in Fukushima, a huge amount of radioactive contamination of the water, copper oxide is literally your only guarantee to decontaminate from radioactive material. This is what we gave to TEPCO. TEPCO was shipped huge amount of this copper oxide in different form as, what was it called? Talcum powder lotion. We have the shipping documents for it. TEPCO didn't want it to be called CO2. It's called as talcum powder lotion. We have all the shipping documents. And now that the gentleman who was part of the TEPCO to decontaminate is the director of the Keshe Foundation in Japan. We met him last week when seeing the machine last Tuesday. Now we are in that process. So if you come across radioactive condition where we expect the number of radioactive reactors to go off, what we call the power stations, in a case of a disaster, copper oxide is the only solution which gives you sediment free, germ free and radioactive free. So bear this in mind. What we need to do is, we can do it. It's the beautiful position which Benjamin is in. Benjamin, you're back online. Is Dr. Nash with you? Hello, Benjamin.
Yes, sir.
Yes, you are with Dr. Nash. Listen, what we want you to do, you have proven that this water is cleaned out of the sediments, yeah? What I want you to ask your team in conjunction with the Atomic Energy Authority of Ghana, because you have the access facilities to it, to do two more further tests on the water from the rivers. One is test the water for germs and bacteria. Okay?
Biology.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We are writing.
Okay. We need to test, okay, now we know the sediment. Forget about CO2. All you want, you carry CO2, carry CO2 too. But we want a test on both river, on one river, take any of the two. Now we know the result, we go for the best, which is the copper oxide. Leave the CO2 out. When do another test and give us the result in respect to bacteria and germs or whatever is in the water before and after. Okay? In the video you showed us last week, the week before, you showed us people washing the animals, the blood of animals in the rivers and everything. So these rivers are fully contaminated. Yeah?
E. coli.
So I want you to ask the authorities within the institute to, do a bacteria test, a full test, like this report for sediment, if we can have a bacteria test. And anything else which is there. The second thing, because you are part of the Atomic Energy Authority of Ghana, you're within the institute, ask them to do the same, which is, will you have radioactive material with you? If you can contaminate the water as it is with radioactive material and then add the CO2 into it and report to us back on the cleaning of the water from radioactive material. This is very important. Okay. These are we need. If it can be done very rapidly by next week, because I know you're very slow, it's very difficult to get you moving fast. But even the waters you have now, you still have the two waters after cleanup and the normal. Test the same waters again for bacteria and germs and do a simple test of adding radioactive material to the river and its copper oxide, and we would like to see the report in the residual or in the water. The result will come 100% in the direction of the cleanup of the radioactive material. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
And we know this because TEPCO has confirmed it. We know this because we shipped enough material into TEPCO. So this is important. Maybe for the first time, Africa can help America in the case of disaster, that the people in America know how to help themselves if any nuclear material is released in the environment due to whatever accident. Not a disaster, we most probably sooner or later, we already know there's a huge amount of radioactive material in the coast of Italy. The African nation, with the small budget you have, you can prove to the rest of the world how they can help themselves. As I told you, Africa will become the flag bearer of the new technology. Yeah?
Yes, so, sir.
If you can do it through the Iranian government with support of the Ghana, because I know there's a close collaboration between Iran and Ghana, we will release the technical data into IAEA as part of the collaboration with the Keshe Foundation Iranian Atomic Energy Authorities and Ghanaian Atomic Energy. We collaborate as three organizations to become a standard for the new standard for decontamination of radioactive situation. We know the answer because we know it from the Fukushima. Certain radioactive material, copper oxide, is effective. If you see any residual, you add CO2 to it for another level. And if you have beta from certain materials, you use the water which you showed it had a mercury in it, that mercury will convert to gold. Becomes a national asset. I'll guide you all the way through it. This is what's happening in Fukushima in Japan. And what you set up, we will show. When I'm in China, we do these tests very rigorously with the Chinese military and Chinese government for cleanup. But I know from 25 years ago when I used to work in Russia, in Kazakhstan, we had this problem with a lot of lakes which are heavily radioactive or mercury contaminated. This allows a new cycle. With a little amount of expenses, we can clean up most of the problems. So please ask your collaborators in IAEA, in what you call Ghana Agency, Nuclear Agency, Atomic Energy Authorities, to first of all test these waters for microbes. I'm sure CO2 will give you clearance because we've done this with the South Sierra Leone University. We already have a data from South Sierra Leone University, which they did the data on Ebola when we had the crisis. And from the new atomic site, you can ask your colleagues, because you are in the Atomic Energy Authority, to do a quick test. It takes you 5 minutes, literally. You add CO2, you let it settle in 1 hour, and take the waters, the one which is not treated with the CO2 and the one, and you just measure, you got the Geiger meters and everything there, you can do the Geiger counters very quickly. Could we have this report within next week?
Nash, sir, I happen to give him a lot of stuff, but they cannot maybe cope with my rate of, sample. So, he had to answer for himself.
Dr. Nash?
Yeah, Mr. Keshe, with the microbiological... With the microbiological analysis that assignment you've given us, yeah, that will be done at another lab, but within the same Ghana Atomic Energy. So we're now going to make arrangements with them and then get the samples for them. So hopefully, I think a week will be too short for us.
No problem, 2 weeks. Humanity has been contaminating for hundreds of years. Yeah. 2 weeks is nothing.
2 weeks, that'll be fine.
But at least if you have any preference. But I know as a nuclear physicist, it should not take you more than 10 minutes to give us a result on the nuclear contaminated.
Yeah.
You have plenty of cobalt. You have plenty of cobalt residual from your disinfected units, which I know you have. For radiation system use. I know a lot about your organization, don't worry. So,
if so
you
much.
Could ask, listen, we are nuclear physicists and a few governments have access to these kind of technologies. We collaborate with with different governments. We know what you carry. We're trying to support you with the cobalt for decontamination radiation of the hospital units. I know what you carry in that place. I've seen a full, inside report. Mm. That's why we are there to support. So you have some old materials, cobalt and the others, which are there. If you can contaminate it or the water contaminated water, just add it as a contaminated water. Use the CO2 and use the copper oxide. CO2 will not show. CO2 will show maybe partially for alpha, beta, you need to use mercury which comes from the water. If you have cleared the water with sediment, I think you won't see such a good result. But if you, in your test in sediments, you find mercury in your sediments, then don't touch. Take the, to put the sediments back in the water, add your radioactive material and add the CO2 and then measure the sediments. Now you should see a lot of gold. You recuperate all the gold plus you convert the mercury to gold. So this becomes national asset. You understand?
Yes, please. Yes,
so yeah. This is a huge, any mercury, if any of this residual is in the two rivers, you see mercury, mercury is your national asset that, that converts to gold. If you take the residual of the nuclear materials which you have and add copper oxide or CO2 into it as a mixture, you will see gold will rain down, you will see it. This is how we supported, what do you call it, TEPCO.
TEPCO?
Yeah, TEPCO with the Fukushima disaster, they are collecting gold from their tanks.
Mm-hmm.
50 right. kilos per tank is on average.
I see.
You understand?
So, yes,
because these rivers are getting exploited for gold, and they're using the mercury in it, it's very easy. If you have the radioactive material in conjunction with the gold, CO2 or copper oxide, you might need CH3 to create a chain reaction, which what we sent to TEPCO as part of the conversion of tritium. You should be able to see gold dripping at the bottom. This is the only solid because you will see the shiny bit. Yeah?
Yeah.
So it becomes a national asset. You can literally sell the gold for your government and subsidize all your researchers.
That's great. Yeah. That's great.
We so brought you gold. We brought you gold in the form of Benjamin. Now you can produce gold to sell. That's why I said to the CIA when they brought us into you, when I told the American government when we were introduced to you through the organization of CIA. When we were sent in to collaborate with you, we said when we come in, we make sure Ghana Space Institute and Ghana Nuclear would not look outside for any financing. Because I was aware, I studied the topology, I studied the structure of what is in Ghana and how people operate. And I was aware of this, but we have to wait till the data is there. Now the data is there, we can be open. And I thank the people within the structure of the CIA who brought us to you, because this allows us a lot of work to be done. And it's a great collaboration. And I thank the head of Ghanaian Atomic Energy and the new deputy which you received. We openly collaborate with you in every aspect. Thank you very much, Dr. Nash.
Mr. Keshe, Dr. Nana just walked in, but she's picking a call. And one of the managers for the Biological Institute is also here, Doctor, in the person of Dr. Gordon Amenope, who yesterday took me. Okay, Dr. Amenope, yeah.
Hello, Keshe.
Hello, yes. Good afternoon, Doctor. We just received a report, beautiful report from your institutes, from your organization, Atomic Energy. What it'll be interested, yes. We've seen the sediments. What we requested now, is it possible to have a biological report? The decontamination and pre-contamination of the water, microbes and everything else. That not only we reduce the sediments and the clarity, but is the process, has the process, the waters you have left, have is decontaminated from any infection, Ebola, E. coli, whatever. Is it possible if you could have such a report from you, please?
All right, Dr. Keshe, my unit actually deals with plants, animals, and so forth. And we will not be responsible for decontamination.
But you have friends within the organization, I presume.
Yes, okay. But I wanted to talk about different issues.
Okay, please go ahead.
Good. My unit is Nuclear Agriculture Research Institute.
Yes.
And we normally change the genes genetical makeup, the genes and chromosomes of crops using nuclear, peaceful nuclear techniques. Right, and the current problems we are having now are related to climate. The rainfall figures are not encouraging. So we want to come out with plants that will have genes that can convert little water into food. In other words, drought resistant plants.
Can I ask you a question? Can I ask you a question, doctor?
Yes.
We know in Africa, I worked in Africa for a long time and I've been in the interior. We know that African ladies carry sometimes 40 different kind of seeds for different climates. They forecast how the weather is going to be, and that year they use a given seed. Yes. Is there a seed in Ghana or in part of your structure without genetically embedded modified, which had the property that it can live in a drier condition? There must have been, must be local seed.
Yes, we have some seeds which can actually do well. Example, lima beans can thrive very well under drought conditions. We have other crops species that actually thrive well under drought condition, like cassava, special breed cassava are also there. Although they are not seed, but they are vegetatively propagated.
So it is in the genes structure of the seeds or the, what you call the fibers, to be able in their memory chain that somewhere down the line they could stand the droughts in Africa. That's why they survived. That's why we got them now, because genetically it's recent. Okay, what you can do, I suggest you test. This goes back in the test we showed a couple of, 2 or 3 weeks ago, from the research from our group in US and in Philippines. If you put your seeds, you saw the copper oxide, the which is brought the sediment down from the water, put the same copper oxide in a container and add water to it.
Yes.
Take the water or put the copper oxide in a container and put another container inside it with water and put your seeds in it for about 10 minutes, no more than 10, 15 minutes. And take the seed out and plant it. These seeds will will take up to 80% less moisture to grow, which means any drought condition can be met. These seeds will grow much faster for a shorter season. We know this. I did this test over 9 years ago, 8 years ago. So instead of going genetically modifying, trying to stand drought and pest, if you go on the Keshe Foundation, the work 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago is on the net. It's on the agricultural green, what do you call it, blueprint. Just try. Benjamin is with you. Don't do anything else. Just put your seeds in the same CO2 copper oxide or in the same CO2 which you use to create the sediments to clean up the water. Put this CO2 or copper oxide in the bucket and put a bucket inside it and put your seeds and water in there. Leave that bucket for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, an hour, whatever you choose, because the more you leave it, the more you strip the outer energy of the gene, and you go back to original seeds thousands of years ago. We know this from experience in Belgium. So take your seed, put it in a bucket, put some water in it, and put that bucket in a bucket which contains CO2, and then leave it for 10 or 15 minutes. Just stir it and cultivate.
All right.
Okay, can we go to United States to Dr. Mugaba in US?
I'm online.
Okay, can you enlighten us, Star, because you're going to be part of the Keshe Foundation in Africa, and you've done these tests. Can you explain to our colleagues in Ghana what you did and what the result was, that they know they have a guideline?
Yes, please. I planted potatoes treated with water as control and treated with CO2 gas water. And the ones that I treated with CO2 gas water matured 2 weeks earlier. And the weight per potato was not different from control. Maturity was faster for potatoes treated with GANS water, CO2 GANS water, and all I did was submerge the potatoes in CO2 GANS water for 5 hours before planting. And my presentation, I can see it online. I guess Rick has it online.
Yes. What we've seen with Dr. Mukoba is that it supports the research in the past that if you can even nano-coat copper pipes before you outside of the pipe that pass the water through, you will find out that the harvest is much better. You'll get a better harvest too. So, and you need less water. Our research in US from the Keshe Foundation Innovation shows you don't need to water 7 days a week. You can water twice a week, for example. So, by the use of CO2, water of the CO2, you never change the amount. You keep the bucket of the CO2, you just put a bucket of water, and you just whatever you need to put. You want to put potatoes, you put it in there and leave it for a while. You want to do seeds, you do it for 1 hour. Potato is different because it's more dense. With seeds, we've seen 10 to 20 minutes is more than enough, and you plant the seeds. And then you can even water it with the water of the CO2, the same water which you put the seed in. You can keep it in the bucket and keep on watering the plant with it. You'll find out you need less, much less water, which instead of let's say 100 liter, you use something like 20 liter of water. The harvest we have seen in research done, very controlled research in Belgium, your harvest goes up by 3 to 5 times in foliage, which is good for the animals, and you will see that the cultivation time reduces by up to 30%. So you can cultivate in the time of drought in a shorter time, get the harvest, and you can do a lot with it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Dr. Kwagawa is going to run the Keshe Foundation in Kenya. And we bring all the Keshe Foundations in Africa together to collaborate. Is there anything else from Ghana you would like us to help you with, or because we can collaborate together?
All right. Can we get the Kenyan contact so that we can communicate with him?
If you want, I send him with pleasure to Ghana. He can stay with you for a while. He's a doctor in agriculture, he's an economy. He can help you and then transfer the knowledge. I know you have a close connection with the atomic energy in Kenya, that he can transfer the whole thing to Kenya. Some of your colleagues in Kenya already use the energy units which was built by Benjamin, which they took to Kenya. I organize that. He will come to you, and then from there to Ghana. Is that good with you, Dr. Oba?
That's perfect. I would also very much like to go there and talk to Benjamin and the rest of his group. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We organize this within the next 2 weeks before we go to China. Thank you very much. Thank you indeed.
And I want to make another submission. from Ghana. Oh,
go ahead, please.
All right. Are you please in favor of GM modifying crops?
No.
No.
All right. In my job line, I don't do gene transfer or genetic engineering, but what I am trained to do is to use nuclear energy to modify the genetic composition of crops for drought tolerance, disease resistance, high yield, high beta carotene levels to prevent blindness of children. Is it also acceptable to you using nuclear energy, pure nuclear energy, not gene slicing?
Okay, as you know, I'm a nuclear physicist.
Right.
And so I have got a fairly good experience in this respect. In the nuclear industry, we use radiation, which is a one-way track. We only give the magnetical. When you use the CO2 the way we just discussed, you will find out you get what you're looking for because you use a plasma condition, which means you give and take, and it brings a new dimension into the world of seed genes or genetic. At the moment you bombard the seed to change it. In fact, if you use the CO2 or use, if you don't get the result with the water of the CO2, use the water of copper oxide for a more effective pressure. In a way, it's not a radiation pressure, it's a magnetic gravitational pressure. So, in a way, the seed will modify to what it needs to do. You understand? So,
all right.
And it's the way the universe works. In nuclear industry, we force energy in. With the new plasma technology, we allow the seed to find its own balance. And it works more effective. You have no radiation hazard. You don't need to decontaminate anything. But the only thing is, if you don't get the result you want with the CO2, go one level higher, go to copper oxide. And usually with the seeds, the copper oxide is the maximum you need to do. So if you ask Benjamin, if you have the seeds, do the radiation process and do the same in parallel with CO2 and copper oxide. Or if you want to increase the energy, add a CH3 to it. Or you can mix these. And you find out with less than no cost, you can do exactly what you need for. But it, in a way, if you look at it in nuclear industry, radiation is adding energy into.
Okay.
Correct?
Yes.
This way, you add a plasmatic energy, which is balanced and acceptable to the seed. So you get the same result, a balanced seed, and exactly how you wanted it to work with zero cost.
All right, so I can understand you that your method, CO2 plus CA3 method, is to reverse the plant to original state that God actually made it in the days of old.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes, we've seen this result up to now.
All right. What if I want to increase beta carotene level 100-fold?
Play with a mixture of 3 or 4 GANSes.
All right.
Till you get the mixture you like, with let's say 10% of this, 20% of the other. You see where you are giving energy or where you want to take energy. Copper oxide has the property of giving, taking energy in certain levels. But if you add it with zinc oxide GANS, which Benjamin can make very easily, you find out it allows the balance within the seed structure. We know this from research in couple of cases. So Benjamin has to give you a separate, let's say, four or five different GANSes, which cost nothing, you've seen it in your center. And then you play with different mixture till you get it right and the seed will respond, because it's not the radiation. The problem with the genetic modification now is we radiate to dislocate and put it where we want it. This way is a gravitational magnetical, it goes to where you want it, but it's in balance with it. So it's not genetically modified. It accepts the condition, it processes itself to what you want it to do, without any radiation at no cost.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you very much. I've done certain amount of work as a nuclear physicist in this far, in this section of the seeds. I started it in 2008, and I have seen the crops usually die the last four months more than their usual, and you can keep on cutting the harvest and it comes back.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Yes,
thanks for your
Dr. Keshe, I would like to hand over the mic to Nana.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Nana is here with me.
Thank you very much indeed, Doctor.
Thank you.
I will explain everything to Benjamin in how to make the materials ready for you that you just test.
All right.
Thank you.
Good day, Mr. Keshe. This is Nana.
Hi, good day, Dr. Nagana. How are you, Dr. Nana?
I'm fine, thank you.
Are you happy with the results?
Sure. We're making a lot of progress and I'm happy with it. So we've been discussing it at the authority level from time to time, and on the MOU, I think it's close to final. But the lawyer wanted to be clear on some things. Especially she wants to know how Keshe Foundation will be infused into the Ghana Atomic Energy Commission system. So should it be a department under the Ghana Space Science and Technology Institute, or it should be a joint company?
We prefer to keep our independence to be a joint company, but embedded in Ghana Spaceship Institute or Energy, which is the Atomic Energy Authority.
Okay.
Because I know if the rule changes in the country and the leadership or the parliament passes a new law, we lose the control. But this way we stay independent, that we can operate and serve the nation.
Okay. So we can make it clear in the MOU then. So I'll
yes,
put
please.
Some things together and share it with you again.
Thank you very much indeed for your time. Dr.
Sure.
Nana,
thank you.
How can we proceed with these results from the what we've seen from the Atomic Energy Authorities now?
Yeah. We need to
commercialize it rapidly, or can it be used to be commercialized?
Yeah, we need to go over all the tests again, all the experiment again, through the scientific processes, do the tests again, and invite other institutions which are doing similar work to be witnesses to those tests. And then we can go public. Once we go
public... We are already public. You're listened to by 100 million people. If this is not public,
no,
I don't know what is public.
Okay, I mean to get it accepted in the Ghanaian community.
Yeah.
We need to talk to, we have Water Research Institute or Commission Institute.
Yeah.
Who is the authority for water issues or water resources in Ghana. So we need to have all our documents right and then talk to them. They can give us the authority to probably go ahead with water treatment and other issues about water in Ghana.
I think your biggest problem is your secretary to get the figures in the right column. Otherwise, everything else is easy.
Yeah. Okay. So.
Thank you very much, indeed. Thanks for your long-standing collaboration and cooperation with us.
Thank you, Mr. Keshe.
Thank you indeed for your time. Thank you indeed.
Thank you.
Benjamin.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. please produce as much as you can the gases of CO2, copper oxide, CH3, and zinc oxide, and provide these in a given quantity to the doctor that they can use it for their seed. Make sure there is no salt content, because if you have a salt content, the salt will transfer its plasmatic condition to the seed. And then that can cause you sometimes it's to benefit. It allows the salt in the seed to extract moisture from the environment, so it becomes a sink for watering the plant itself. And in some plants, this works the other way around. So try to give them the GANSes with salt water, don't wash it, and try to give them GANS with the washed GANS. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what this will do, the plant is looking for a moisture, and the moisture comes through the salt content within the DNA of the gene of the seed. So if you add in some seeds the salt water to be there, because now salt behaves as a GANS state of the salt, not as a salt as matter state, will bring the gene into a state of being like a thirsty, and instead of drought killing it from outside, it calls for the water, the moisture to come to it, and it creates its own water moisture. In some countries, we've seen that effect. In some countries, due to the climate, it doesn't seem to be responding. So allow them to test both with the salt and without the salt in all four of them, please.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Keshe, I'm already collaborating with him in other, crop matters. Yes, I think last 3 days. Huh? Last 3 days, he took me around Ikrabo lands where I can do a lot of experiments concerning agriculture. So it's in line. So I'm working with him already.
What is got to learn, Benjamin, get yourself a meter, 2 meter of copper pipe, nano coat it from outside, cover it with a plastic tube, and let the water go through it very slowly. And feed your plants all the time with this pipe. You understand?
Yes, sir.
So what you do, as you water, you feed. You add energy to your water, plasmatic, and the plants will grow totally different. And when you do it, try to spread the watering, not to every day. If you plant one side every day, plant this water, measure the amount of water, that you know how much you're watering, and that's what it is. You got to understand, at the moment, water shortage, water distribution, agriculture has become a big game. For example, China is short of water. What they have done, they have leased properties in Africa and in Argentina. What they're buying is a water rain, they're called, water rain purchase for agriculture. The water rain in those districts are used to make soya to be shipped back to China. So you got to take a measurement of how much water you're feeding to the plants, not just feeding it and looking at the plant, how it's growing or if it's growing faster. Measure if you give 100 liter there, if you're giving 20 liter. This is the real test of the technology. You understand?
Yes.
And connect you, if you're watering with a hose pipe, measure the water. If you're measuring with the hose, with the tanks, add a copper pipe, nano coated from outside, not inside. Put a plastic on it that it doesn't get destroyed, and water it and measure it. You will see the difference. Very quickly, you see 70-80% reduction in the water consumption, and you will see up to 30%, up to 4 times, 5 times more foliage. So when you work with them, work correctly, and then you do the seeds with the salt, without the salt, and then you see how they want.
Okay.
There is no need to use of radiation anymore in any food and agriculture. Now we have this technology.
Okay. I was about to, before I completed with the water thing, I showed a picture of what we have actually done. And
carry on. Would you like to share with us the screen?
Okay.
Is there a problem?
Yeah, there's a problem, but we are on the...
It's coming up. You're coming up. There we are.
Okay.
You have the last picture we see now. Yeah, please.
That's the last picture we see. This is what we are about to do. So you see the ends. There's a connection point at where the tube bends. That is where we are going to put the nano-coated tube outside so that it will water the plant. And these beds have seeds which have been nano-treated in different configurations. So I have all the permutations also drawn, and once it's ready, my IT guy is a bit indisposed, so he's not here, but I have seen that he has done a lot of work so far. There are some few corrections I want him to do on them, and then we can share it so that those who have expert knowledge in this field can also add their knowledge to it. So that is
Benjamin, when do you start this process?
I just went to see Dr. Amenope to see the land, but already I have started the process already somewhere, but I'm not getting the full cooperation from that end, so I have even abandoned that project. But this one, I will have people who will be able to man it for me, because here, if you give something...
You
to
know
somebody,
what we can do, Benjamin?
Yes, sir.
The
yes,
biggest
sir.
Agricultural university in Africa, the most famous one, has always has been South Sierra Leone University.
Okay.
It was a jewel in the crown of the agricultural universities in Africa till the problem started a few years ago. We always promised, the chancellor of the university, he wants to bring back the university back to what it was. We have still the situation with Ebola there, but maybe between you and Dr. Hava, which is coming to you from United States, we can join you up with this professors in South Sierra Leone University, because they need this for food.
Okay.
Would it be possible that we can put you together in that way? Because one of the seeds I think you got to try, except cassava, is rice.
Rice. Okay. We are in position.
Try to see how you can do. Because what Americans have done over the past 20 decades, they imported American rice so cheap that it was not worth for the farmers locally to produce it. So now they are forced to buy, and the new seeds are agriculturally modified that it doesn't give them what they need for the next harvest. If you can show how you can reverse what I call the genetic modification of the seeds, which you can do, and share it with the scientists in Kenya and in Sierra Leone, I think we achieve a major production in rice. And we can even go back to the original rice, which a lot of we can grow in the dry season.
Okay.
This is fantastic. You have put in front of me in that picture what I've been trying to do for nearly 2 years. You dangled the bait, so now I bet. Now you better do. And I'll bring as part of the collaboration the director of the Central Bank of ex-director of Central Bank of Sierra Leone to be collaborating with you with this. And he's ex-director of the World Bank, and he's very good in these things. He is from Africa, and he understands the problems.
and we can raise a lot of funds in Africa for this this project to stop the processed genes.
Okay. So in line with this, I have told Nash that I'm bringing some samples to his lab. So we'll do after and before soil sample analysis. And the water that will be used to water this crop will be tested periodically to find what is in the intake point and the, what do you call it, the outtake point and the intake point. So we'll do that and see what is inside before it gets past the nano exit, so that we'll also know.
Can I ask our colleague in US, how fast can you get to Ghana? Is your suitcase ready?
Oh, I'm ready, but I thought I would go to Kenya first and then go to Ghana. That may be easier.
Either way, let me know when you travel and we finance the rest of it the minute you tell me you're moving.
Okay. Thank you.
Please, because I think with your experience you've done, you can bring correct test trials in Ghana and transfer the knowledge back to Kenya.
Definitely. I look forward to doing that. Thank you.
Anytime you fly, we'll support you. It's all in your hand from now on.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Mr. Keshe.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a beautiful job, Benjamin. Try to support the measurement of the what do you call it, microbes and bacteria in the water if you can do that. I could carry the
okay, we'll do that.
To China, and the contamination of radioactive material is a gift from Africa to Americans if this disaster happens and we get radiation spillage, because the number of nuclear reactors sits on the right boundaries of the plates. It'll be fantastic. You're sitting right inside the Atomic Energy Authority, and we can ask our colleagues in Iran for a direct collaboration and transfer of technology in different ways.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Thanks, thanks, Dr. Nana, Dr. and all your support in the Institute. All the best. Okay. We'll see you next Thursday.
So they are interested in the space aspect also. So I told them we are in position to build our first spacecraft here, and it has gone around. Actually, Professor Dr. Shlow should have been here, but because of a lot of meetings that he, you know, he's having now, he couldn't be here.
We collaborate very quickly. We need for them to appoint people who are as part of their space technology, who you have thought and understand the technology. We bring them in the space in the spaceship team. We bring when they let them appoint Ghanaian scientists who understand our technology in the space, and then we bring them straight away into the Spaceship Institute, what they call it, teaching group. Pardon? Hello, you can't hear you. You're down somewhere. Get the microphone.
Okay, we are saying that our UPS will go off any moment from now.
Thank you very much indeed. Thanks for being with us.
And quickly, Dr. Keshe, this is Godwin again.
Yes, Dr. Godwin.
A lot of seeds are being sent to the moon for cosmic radiation mutation breeding. So I'm interested in space technology. If you can pack some seeds and send it there, and then bring it up and see how they can actually grow in comparison with the one we modified in Ghana.
With the greatest of pleasure. I'll organize it with Benjamin.
All right.
And we'll speak together in time to sort it out.
All right.
Thank you very much, Dr. Godwin. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye-bye.